So it's my pleasure to introduce Marco Congedo. Marco is an Italian scientist now working in France, in Grenoble, at CNRS. He's research director at the GIPSA lab. And I think a big part of his work has been devoted to the development of mathematical methods for classification of EEG signals, and particularly for BCI. And you have done a lot of work on Riemannian geometry in particular for classification, and that's what your talk is going to be about today. So thank you very much for being here, and please go on. Thank you, Marco.
Yeah, thank you. Do you see my screen, full screen?
Yes.
Okay, so everything is all right. Okay, the only thing is that I don't have a clock. So could you please tell me when I am 40 minutes? In 40 minutes, yes. Can you please tell me something?
After 40 minutes, yeah. After
yeah, that will be, okay, thank you very much. And thank you very much for your invitation. I'm very glad to be here, although you put me in a very difficult position, which is to this position to talk about mathematics to mathematicians, which is, of course, very very difficult, if not impossible. So what I would like to do today is to talk about Riemannian geometry from an intuitive point of view, and especially from a practical point of view. Because what we have been doing in Grenoble, I think we were the first to do those kind of things, actually to introduce those tools in the field of brain-computer interface, indeed, as you said. And that turns out to be very useful and very powerful. And of course, we have been developing methods to classify data using Riemannian geometry. And this is what I would like to talk today. So my talk is in two parts. In the first one, I would like to introduce some basic concepts that are very useful and to explain what all this Riemannian geometry stuff is about and why it is useful for us and for other people in many domains now that it is used. And in the second part, I will talk more specifically on some recent advances in this field, and in particular about something that we call transfer learning, which is something I will talk about more precisely in the second part. So this is more specific to BCI fields, although it may be useful and used in other field of research as well. Okay, so let's start. This talk is divided in five parts. So a small introduction, then I will introduce fundamental objects in the Riemannian geometry, and particularly for the use of the Riemannian manifold of positive definite matrices, which is the manifold that we use. And then I will talk about how those concepts and objects, mathematical objects, can actually be used in classification. And then I will give an example on how this has been used in brain-computer interface field. And then finally, I will just release some resources, basically access to public data and code, if there is anybody that would like to use those in their own research. Okay, so Riemannian geometry was introduced by Bernard Riemann. That's why it's called Riemannian, of course. And the reason why this great mathematician started investigating these tools is because, I mean, he had a question. The question is, how can I determine that the Earth is not flat locally, meaning without an external point of view? So how can I determine that locally? So this was his question. And then that's why he actually started developing some fundamental concepts that then were taken by other people. And of course, we all know that Albert Einstein has been developing the relativity theory thanks to some work that has been done by, in particular by Gregorio Ricci Cubastro, and particularly even more by Tullio Levi Civita, that were developing in Italy the differential calculus that then has been used by Einstein in his theory. So this is a book from Tullio Levi Civita, edited in Rome in 1901. 1925, sorry. And it says, it starts this book with a very interesting sentence. It says that basically complex algebraic relations translate simple geometric properties. And thus, using the geometric language, we can express algebraic relations clearly, concisely, in a way that is accessible to intuition. And this is a key point for me, because as I said before, I'm not a mathematician. The only access I have to mathematics is by intuition. And using Riemannian geometry is indeed very useful for me, because it really gives me a solid grasp to some geometrical concepts that I can imagine, and I can really use my intuition in working with those things. And I'm glad that Levi Civita said the same things some 100 years ago. Okay, so let me give you an example on how actually how we can translate algebraic notions into geometrical concepts. For example, let's take a very important object, which is the principal square root of a positive definite matrix. So this principal square root, from an algebraic point of view, all we can say is this, that if we take the principal square root and we multiply by itself, then we get the matrix, okay? And that's pretty much all we can say, but although that there is the principal square root is the only symmetric one, although there are many matrices that fulfill this property, the principal square root is the only symmetric one. So that's pretty much all we can say. But from a geometric point of view, and then we will see more precisely in the manifold of positive definite matrices, then we see that if we move along the geodesic, going from matrix P to the identity, which is the origin of this manifold, so it corresponds to zero in Euclidean geometry, then we find exactly in the middle, we find this object, okay? The principal square root, so it is in the middle in between P and I. And then if we keep moving and we advance as much as we advanced from the square root to I, and we keep moving, then we arrive to the inverse of the principal square root. And then if we keep moving by the same amount, then we arrive to the inverse of P, okay? So all those matrices are all along the same geodesic. And so we see how an algebraic concept is enriched from a geometric point of view. And for instance, of course, because basically what we are trying to do is to define a metric space. And when we adopt a specific metric, then we have a closed form expression for the distance. And we can see, for example, the distance between the square root and the inverse of the square root is the same as the distance between P and I. And this has an expression, which is the sum of the square of the logarithms of the eigenvalues of matrix P. So then we have some very useful quantitative characterization of those distances. Okay, so the fundamental object on a manifold of this kind is the geodesic. So if you move, for example, from Berlin to Lyon, everybody knows it looks like you're going straight, but actually you're not going straight, you're making a car. And this car is ideally the shortest path that the plane can do in order to go from Berlin to Lyon, okay? So the shortest path is curved. So in an Euclidean, non-Euclidean space, we have this concept of curved paths, of curved lines, basically. So we generalize the concept of straight line as geodesics. And when we are in non-Euclidean spaces, then non-conventional things happen. For example, if you take a sphere, you consider the north and the south pole, then you can easily see that there are infinite geodesics relying the north pole to the south pole, because all meridians are actually good candidates to be a shortest path to go from the north pole to the south pole. Also, we can see on a sphere again, then you can draw actually triangles, but in those triangles, there are two right angles, which is kind of course, non-compatible with the Euclidean geometry. And then for those that wonder what are those geodesic on the sphere, then they are arc on great circles, okay? So whatever two points you take, then a geodesic is an arc on great circles. All right, so in a slightly more formal way, we can see that when you are in a flat surface, then, and suppose you are now moving along this flat surface at constant velocity, then if you do not change direction, then the acceleration vector is null, is zero, okay? There is no acceleration. So as long as you do not accelerate, you never you don't have any acceleration. Whereas if you are in a curved surface like this one, then you, even if you try to go as straight as you can, then you must accelerate. So you must accelerate in this direction, okay? From north to south or south to north. So this gives us the definition of a geodesic in a flat space. So in Euclidean, for example, geometry, then it is when you are at constant velocity, you are at zero acceleration. So there is no acceleration along those geodesics, but in a curved space, then you only have zero tangential acceleration. So the only acceleration that is allowed is normal to the surface. So as long as you don't have any tangential acceleration, then you are on a geodesic. So this is how it is defined, geodesic. So a geodesic is a path where the acceleration is only normal to the surface, okay? So in a sense, it is the shortest path between two points. Okay, so as I said before, we use mainly, not only, but mainly the manifold of positive definite matrices. So let's define those positive definite matrices. So this is the definition that is usually used, but is only one among the possible definition, and is not the one that I prefer because to me, at least, it's not the most intuitive. There are many other definitions. So this is one, all its eigenvalues are real and positive. So the matrix, of course, is non-singular. So this is a definition. Another definition is that you can write such a matrix as the products of a matrix transposed by itself. And this, of course, applies both in the real and the complex case. And another definition is that such a matrix, a positive definite matrix, has a unique Cholesky factor, okay, like this. And also, it has a unique positive definite square root, as we said before. So all those are actually definitions, because in the sense that if this condition is fulfilled, then this is a positive definite matrix. And these kind of objects are very, very important in signal processing in applied mathematics, because we find them in many ways. For example, covariance matrices are in general positive definite matrices, kernels, tensors, Fourier cospectral matrices, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So is actually those positive definite matrices are actually very, very, very important objects that we find in many, many instances. Okay, so in our case, we are going to talk about EEG data. So EEG data is a multivariate time series. I think in Italian, they call it historical series. So multivariate time series. And so we have some signal that over time, basically, and we have a multiple of electrodes. So we have multivariate in this sense. And so in order to represent this data on the positive definite manifold, we use covariance matrices. Okay, so the covariance matrices, as you know, so a covariance matrix holds in diagonal elements the variance of the signal of each time series, and in the off diagonal element, the covariance of those time series taken two by two, and of course the matrix is symmetric. And if we put those points in three dimensions, because there are only three, let's say 3 degrees of freedom, in the sense that there are only three, you can define completely this matrix by only 3 points, since the matrix is symmetric, then you see how this manifold would look like in an Euclidean space. So this is called the convex cone. And you see that those covariance matrices actually are constrained within this cone. And this is due to the Cauchy-Schwarz inequality, okay, which is represented in this equation. I think you can see my cursor, okay, so this equality, inequality, so so the point must be in this cone, and so now we can define some fundamental objects of the Riemannian manifold of positive definite matrices. So what it is, so a smooth Riemannian manifold is a topological space that is locally similar to a Euclidean space, and of course has a globally defined differential structure. So it is equipped with an inner product on the tangent space. So as soon as we equip the tangent space, which for this manifold is actually identified with the space of symmetric matrices. So as soon as we keep this tangent space with a metric, then we are in the realm of Riemannian geometry. Okay, so the manifold is said Riemannian. And this metric is defined at each point and varies smoothly from point to point. Okay, so if we move smoothly, the metric also varies smoothly. And of course, the tangent space at any point is the Euclidean vector space. So, it's an Euclidean vector space. We are going to use this property containing the tangent vectors to all curves on the manifold passing through this point. Okay, that defines which the on which the tangent space is defined. Okay, so this is the definition, more or less. And we are going to endow this manifold with a metric, which is called in many, many ways. I like to call it Fischer metric because it is related to some object that has been studied by Fischer. But in any case, you can call it in many ways, Fischer, Rao metric, affine invariant metric. It has many, many, many different names, but this is the fundamental metric that has a very interesting properties. So this is the metric on the manifold of positive definite matrices for any two tangent vectors, and G is the point on which the tangent space is defined. Of course, we have an associated norm, and when this point G is actually the identity, then the metric becomes the usual Euclidean metric, and the norm becomes the usual Euclidean norm. Okay, so at identity point, then we find again the usual metric. And this is an important point because, as we are going to see, we always, I mean, often define some, we transport points in such a way that the center of mass, also called geometric mean, as we will see, of our observation becomes actually the identity matrix. Okay, so this is about the metric, and then once we have a matrix by some calculus, we find out what is the distance function between any two points, which is always defined, it always exists. So the distance, of course, we can consider the Euclidean distance, which is this one in between two scalar, C1 and C2. And there is also another distance that is very, very well known, which is called the hyperbolic distance, which is this one. It's the same things, but we are taking the logarithm of those points C1 and C2. Okay. And of course, those two distance functions have different properties. In particular, if we consider amplitude, for example, 3.1, 2, and 4, and then we consider their variance. The variance is the square of the amplitude, suppose, I mean, for zero mean numbers. So the variance will be 1, 4, and 16. And then what you can see straight away is that the distance between 1 and 4 is much lower than the distance between 4 and 16, according to a Euclidean distance, but it is the same according to hyperbolic distance. So in a way, hyperbolic distance is actually it's used, and it is actually very useful to compute distances between variances. And this is a very important concept because basically a covariance matrix is a generalization of the variance in multiple dimensions. Okay, so if you want to consider distances between those matrices, because those are point on our manifold of interest, then the hyperbolic distance appears more appropriate. But how to generalize hyperbolic distance from scalar to matrices? And this is the whole questions that has been actually taken mathematicians occupied for a long, long time. And finally, the question has been found. So before to give the definition, so this is actually the equation of the distance between matrix C1 and C2. So it's the sum of the square of the logarithm of the eigenvalues of C1 minus 1 multiplied by C2, or of course, C2 minus 1 multiplied by C1, if you want. There are actually many, many ways in which you can, equivalent expression, many for this distance, but this is the one that is more, the one that we find more often. But more important of all is the properties that this distance have. One important properties, very important, is the congruence or affine invariance. And this invariance says that the distance between A2 point C1 and CQ is the same as the distance between those two points once we apply a congruence, which is a linear transformation in the original space, let's say, by an invertible matrix B. So for whatever non-singular matrix B, these relations hold. So the distance does not change. So this, I guess you can grasp straight away one reason why working with this distance is actually very useful and very handy, because basically this invariance properties is saying us that our distances are invariant by any linear transformation of the data. And the second, which is also very important, is called invariance or invariance by inversion or self-duality in mathematics. And this says that the distance between any two points is the same as the distance between any two matrices once we consider their inverse, okay? So this is also very important. So why those two are important? For now, about the congruence invariance, I already say that, but basically we usually use such a linear model linking our observation X, which is the voltage that we observe on the scalp in EEG, to the unknown sources S, which are basically equivalent dipole into the brain. And but because of physical property of the diffusion of the field in the brain, we can assume a linear relationship, which is given by this equation, where A is what we call the mixing matrix, okay? And if we go in the second order, so we have that the covariance matrix of our data is equal to a congruence of the given by matrix A of the covariance matrix of our sources, okay? So basically what this is saying is that working in the space of electrodes, in the sensor space, so working, for example, with covariance matrix of the data is equivalent to working on the source space, okay? On the space of the actual sources into the brain that have produced these scalp potential differences that we observe on the data. The two are equivalent because this matrix A is fixed over time, because it's given by the geometrical properties and the physical properties of the head and the position, of course, of the electrode. So in a given session is fixed. So working in the sensor space is actually equivalent to working into the source space. So there is no need to do inverse solution, source distribution estimation, and very cumbersome and approximate way to determine the sources. We can simply work in the sensor space, and we are going to have, in theory, equivalent results, in the sense that all the distances between any pair of points that we, or any two observations, is not going to be different. So this is the first important property, and the second one is the invariance by inversion. And the invariance by inversion is important because, suppose now that you have a matrix C which is 3 by 3, and suppose now that the eigenvalue of these matrix are actually the 10, 1, and 0, 1. And suppose the directions explained by the eigenvector associated with those eigenvalues are, for the first two cases, are related to noise, and only the last one, which is very small, is actually related to signal, which is basically often the case with EEG, where the noise is in many situations higher than the signal. So now, as I told you before, the invariance by inversion says that if we invert this matrix, then the distance between any two matrices is going to be the same. But in our case, if we inverse the matrices, then the eigenvalues, they are going to be those one. Okay, so now the signal is actually higher than the noise. So what this is actually doing is that in a way, this invariance by inversion is kind of adjusting to the heterogeneity of the power of each sources, okay? So it doesn't matter if the signal is very high or very low, you have a chance to detect it, okay? So those two properties taken together makes actually Riemann geometry a very powerful tool in our case. So as I told you before, so I already gave you the definition of a distance, which is the sum of the square of the log of the eigenvalues of C1 minus 1 times C2. But you can also write this way, okay, as the square of the Frobenius norm of the log of C1 minus 1 times C2. And it's easy to see that actually this distance is nothing more than a sum of monodimensional hyperbolic, as we have seen before, distances in the scalar case. So in order to see this, take a congruence of the matrix C1 and C2, and this congruence, choose this congruence in such a way that B diagonalizes actually both C1 and C2. So now this is equivalent to the distance between two diagonal matrices, D1 and D2, and such a matrix B always exists. And now when you do that, then you use the right-hand side of the first equation, and then you write this way, and then this you can write as a sum of hyperbolic distances. So this distance is actually a generalization of the hyperbolic distance of in the monodimensional case, as I said before. All right, so this suggests that actually a positive definite matrix can be seen as a generalization of a positive scalar. So we can actually think of it as just a generalization in multiple dimension of a positive scalar. Okay, because the hyperbolic distance, of course, is defined only for positive scalars, and so is the case because those matrices are positive by definition. Okay, so now let's see what is actually the geodesic. So in the Euclidean case, the geodesic is nothing more than a weighted mean, so everybody knows that. And in the case of, so weighted by a parameter t, which is in between 0 and 1, okay, if t is equal to 0, we are at A. If t equal to 1, we are at B. And for t equal to 1 half, we are at the midpoint in between A and B, also called the mean. So for in the case of positive matrices, it's exactly the same thing. So this is the expression. And this expression has exactly the same properties. So for t equal to 0, we are at C1. For t equal to 1, we are at C2. And for t equal to 1 half, we are in the midpoint, which is also called the geometric mean. Because actually this is the generalization to matrices of the geometric means of scalars, which is the mean that is defined, as we will see, as a minimizer of the hyperbolic distances. Okay, so we used, not we, I mean, mathematicians have introduced this symbol to define the geodesic, okay, C1, and then these symbols with the t. And if there is not t, we understand that we are talking of the geometric mean, so the midpoint of the geodesic, okay? So we are going to use this. Another important thing of this equation is that you can actually, if you take T in this manifold, you can take T along all over from minus infinity to infinity, and you are going to be always in the within the manifold of positive definite matrices, so you never get out of it. So basically, you can use this to interpolate between points, and you can also use that to extrapolate between parts. So for example, you know C1 and C2, and you want to know what's going to be next. Then you take T larger than one, and you keep extrapolating, extrapolating, extrapolating. Okay, so this is very interesting property of this geodesics. And now let's talk about a very fundamental object, so maybe the most important of all, which is actually a very interesting object from the mathematical point of view, and that is the geometric mean. So we have already defined it actually. So it's the midpoint of the geodesic, but this geometric mean has a very interesting mathematical property. So first of all, is the unique mean that satisfies this equation, meaning that the geometric mean between a matrix and its inverse is actually the identity point. So we have already seen that at the very beginning of the presentation. It is also the solution of this Riccati equation. So G, the geometric mean, is the solution of this Riccati equation. And also it is related to the joint diagonalizer. So if matrix B, as I said before, jointly diagonalize matrix C1 and C2, then you can write G, which is the geometric mean, as a function of the joint diagonalizer, actually of its inverse, A, which is the inverse of B. So you just constrain, you just have to put a constraint on the on D1 and on D2, but you know the joint diagonalizer is actually there are infinite joint diagonalizers. So you just one of those that satisfy this constraint, which is that the product of D1 and D2 is equal to the identity, then its inverse A is a factorization of the full rank, what we call this a full rank factorization of the geometric mean. So this I showed some time ago. I've never seen that before, but it's actually a very interesting property. There are other properties, of course, but those are the most important. So what about the means of many positive definite matrices, of K positive definite matrices? So in this case, we use, just like in the case of scalars, we use the Fréchette variational approach. So for the arithmetic mean, in the case of matrices is defined as the point minimizing the sum of all the distances between the mean and those points. So this is called the dispersion, okay? This is the dispersion around the mean, so the sum of the distance squares, okay? So it's kind of a variance, it's a variance actually. So it's the dispersion around the mean according to the Euclidean metric. And so the solution is this one. And then we find out it is just the sum of the matrices divided by K, so the usual arithmetic mean. And the harmonic mean is similar, okay? And we find out there is a closed form expression again, that is this one. So we need to inverse the matrices before and then to inverse the result, and then we got the harmonic mean. But when we get the geometric mean, things get more complicated. And that's why mathematicians had to work out this problem for a long time, because we see that we cannot easily generalize the geometric mean of scalars to the case of matrices, as we have been doing here, because those expressions for matrices for the arithmetic and the harmonic means are exactly the same for scalars. Just multiply those matrices and then take the kth square root of those numbers, because this multiplication is not commutative. So if you change the order, it doesn't work. And then if you take the other definition, which is this one, so the exponential of the sum of the logarithm of the matrices, one over k, then actually this defines another matrix, which is called log Euclidean, which is not the geometric mean, actually. It is the geometric mean only for diagonal matrices, but it is not in general. So it doesn't work either. So basically something else has to be found. And it turns out that this geometric mean, which is the matrix that solves this minimization problem, which is the matrix minimizing the dispersion according to the Fisher distance we have defined before, then it always exists, is unique, and satisfies this nonlinear equation. Okay, so it is the matrix satisfying this nonlinear equation, and it has no closest form expression, so it must be found by, unless in some specific cases, but in general, does not have a closed form expression, so it must satisfy this equation, and it must be found by iterative algorithms, which are actually pretty simple and pretty effective. We have been doing some work on that too, but that's not a big deal. So we need to use an iterative algorithm to actually estimate those geometric means. All right, so what are the properties of the geometric mean? The consistency with scalars. So those are things that mathematicians like to know. So it's consistent with scalars in this sense. So if all matrices commute, then you can write actually in this way. Joint homogeneity, okay? So if you pre-multiply those matrices by some weights or some scalars, A1, AK, then you can factor those out. Congruence invariance, which is actually the same as the congruence invariance of the distance. So the geometric mean of matrices that have been linearly transformed before is equal to the linearly transformed geometric mean of the original matrices. The inversion invariance, again, which is inherited from the inversion invariance of the distance. So the geometric mean of the invert is the invert of the geometric mean. And then the determinantal equality, which says that the determinant of the geometric mean is equal to the geometric mean of the determinant. Okay, so there are many more interesting properties that this object holds. Okay, I'm not going to go into all of them, but of course, this mean satisfies all the requirements that have been defined in a seminal paper by Ando and other people some 15 years ago. So of course, this mean, which we can actually conceive as a generalization of the hyperbolic, of the geometric mean, sorry, it's of course one of the interesting properties, which is it is going to be resistant to outliers. Okay, so as is in the case for scalars, so here you have an example of some scalars, and then in the second set there is an outlier, and then you can see that the geometric mean in the case of scalars is much more resistant to the outliers as compared to arithmetic mean. So we can see it easily also in a multivariate distribution. So here we have chi-square distribution with outliers, the top line, and we have Gaussian distribution in the bottom line, okay? On the left, we have without outliers, and on the right, we have with outliers. And then we have the arithmetic mean, which is the white square, and the geometric mean, which is the red circle, I mean, on the red disk, sorry. And then, it's easy to see, I mean, as you can see here, especially in the case of chi-square distribution, which are the distributions that we are interested in, then the geometric mean is much better representative of the central tendency of those distributions as compared to the arithmetic mean. So that makes the whole sense why we should use this distance and this mean in our case. Okay, so another very important concept in Riemannian geometry is the concept of parallel transport. So we want to transport basically tangent vectors from one tangent space to another tangent space in such a way to preserve the length of those vectors and the angles between those vectors. So this is called parallel transport. And it turns out that in the case when we want to parallel transport something to the identity, okay, so from any tangent space defined at point G, if you want to transport a vector from that tangent space to the tangent space at the identity, then it's very simple. And it's nothing more than what has been known since ages in signal processing and in statistics, which is called the whitening, okay? If G is the mean, for example, of a certain number of observation, and we want to transport all those observations to the identity, then it's nothing more than making a whitening of those observations. And this actually turns out that this actually works or also for the matrices that defines non-tangent vectors. So if the matrix C is the matrix defined as tangent vectors, then we can transport directly the matrix C, which act directly from, so basically going from C to the tangent vectors, and then moving the tangent vectors in the tangent space of the identity, and then going back to the manifold. All this is done by whitening this matrix, okay? So when we whiten the matrix, we didn't know before, but now we know actually we are parallel transporting this matrix from one tangent vector to another. So this is something that we are going to use very much in the second part of the talk. And of course, the other two objects that, I mean, operations that are very important are the exponential map and the logarithmic map, okay? I'm not going to give the mathematical expressions, but let's say that at the identity, they are defined as the logarithm of the matrix C gives us the tangent vector, and the exponential of the tangent vector gives us the matrix, okay? So this is true only at the identity, but otherwise the expression is a little bit more cumbersome, but this gives a very nice overview of what it is needed to be done when we work in this manifold. I forgot this, sorry. So there is another thing that we use, and it is the vectorization of matrices. So once we go into the tangent space, and remember the tangent space is defined as the ambient space of symmetric matrices. So the tangent, we call those tangent vectors, but those are not vectors, are still matrices. But then in many situations, we want to vectorize those, and we vectorize in this specific way, giving a weight of square root of two to the off diagonal elements only, as you can see here. Element B, C, and E are the off-diagonal matrices of the matrix. So those elements, we give this weight in such a way to preserve basically the norm of those, in such a way, basically in this way, the norm of these vectors is the same as the norm of the matrix, okay? So this is something that we do in order to preserve this property, although it's not necessary, it's better to do this way. But this is a vectorization operation that we define if we want to go from one matrix in the tangent space only, of course, to a vector. And then, of course, we can define the backward operation going from a tangent, so a tangent vector, which is that's been vectorized, going back to the matrix, okay? So with this, I have finished the part on what are the essential object and operations that we need to know in such a way to use this mathematical concept for our studies.
Very good, Marco. You asked me to tell you when you were 40 minutes.
Yes.
And it's about now.
Okay, very good. So classification. So what we do now, how we do use those concepts for doing classification. So we have some multivariate time series, we compute some form of covariance matrix, okay? I'm not going into details, but it's not necessarily the sample covariance matrix, maybe something else in order to encode some interesting properties of this data. It can be any positive definite matrix, but let's say for the moment being it's a covariance matrix, okay? And now we have points on this manifold, okay? And then we compute center of mass of means for those observations in different classes, okay? The blue one, the green one would be different classes. And then it's very simple. So suppose those are training data. And then when you have a new observation and you don't know what is the label of this data, meaning you don't know to what class this observation belongs to, which is indicated here by the question mark, then you just take a look at the distance between this point, this observation, and the two previously computed center of mass, and then you just affect this observation to the class whose was mean is the closest. Okay, so this is called minimum distance to mean classifier. It's the simplest classifier you can think of. It's actually a kind of clustering algorithm. It's very, very, very simple, but still is actually very, very effective. And it has the interesting properties of being resistant to noise. Okay, so this is the first thing that we have been doing, and we still use it because it's actually very handy and it works pretty fine. But this is an example of machine learning on the manifold, directly on the manifold of symmetric positive matrices. But what you can do also is machine learning on the tangent space. So in this case, you do exactly the same things, but then when you are in the manifold, then you define an overall mean of the observation, and then you go into the tangent space. And since this is the tangent space, then you can apply some very complex decision learning, meaning algorithms that you know very well because you have been working with them for a long time, like support vector machine or deep neural networks or whatever you want to do, because this is an Euclidean space. And then you can do now your classification in this space, but you're still making use of the geometry, because those points are not points in the original space, but they come from this encoding, which is done in the manifold, okay? So in a nutshell, what happens is that you have a central number of observations. So Karim before was talking about trials. So you have a number of trials. For each of them, you compute some form of positive definite matrix, usually some form of covariance matrix. You have a number of observations, you compute the geometric mean for those, and then you classify. And when you have to test, then you have an unlabeled BCI trial, okay? You compute the same form of covariance matrix, and then you see, I am closer to the mean of class one, or the mean of class two, or the mean of class three. Of course, this algorithm generalizes to any number of mean, and then you classify this way, and this is very nice. In the tangent space, is a little bit different, actually. So you have, again, those observations, you have the covariance matrices, then you compute an overall mean and you go into the tangent tangent space. We also do a parallel transported identity, okay? And then we have an unlabeled trial, and then you compute the same thing, you again go into tangent space, and then use the decision function that has been given by your complex classifier. SVM, whatever it is, doesn't matter. So this is the general functioning, and those are things that we have introduced in the field. And we have been using this in a number of international BCI decoding competitions in which there are many, many teams from all over the world that participate. And actually we won all of them using Riemannian methods. So this was done by one of my postdoc, Alexander Barachon. So the Riemannian method proved superior to all the others, in some instances, even if there were 400 or 600 competitors, it was very, very good. And this actually helped a lot for the community to start understanding those methods and to make some effort to go through the maths and see, okay, so what should I do now to use those methods? Okay, so let me finish with an example of a P300 brain-computer interface, which is actually calibration-less, meaning that we do not need to calibrate the machine. So in BCI, we always need to calibrate the machine because each brain has unique properties. So when the classifier must be adapted to each user, but we found out a way to do some transfer learning, which is the content of the second talk. And using some transfer learning, we do not need to calibrate anymore. And so how it works is actually an adaptation of the very famous Space Invaders. For those that have my age, they may remember that. And it is the same thing, but now you don't need to shoot anymore with the cannon, because it suffices for you to concentrate on a specific alien for this alien to be destroyed, okay? So let me give you just an overview of how, from the signal processing point of view, how it works. And then I'm going to show you a demonstration. So you have an EEG cap, like this one that has been shown by Karim, for example. And then you have an interface that shows you some aliens. and then it tells you what you should destroy. And if you can destroy it, then at the first run, then it's okay. If you can't, then you have another opportunity. You have 8 possibilities before you can go to the next level. And the way it works is that it queries a database to make this initialization, because we don't do calibration, but it is the machine, the classifier is initialized on the base of a database, and then it adapts in real time to the brain of the user. Okay. And this is done using an adaptive MDM, minimum distance to mean algorithm. So how it works? So let me give you an example. So this is the interface of the Brain Invaders, which is a demonstrator that we have. So here you have the EEG machine with 16 electrodes, and then here you have the user with the G-Cask. Okay, so you should notice that at the beginning of the level, there is one alien that is circled in red. Okay, so I'm gonna to stop it now for you to see it. Okay, oh shit. Sorry. So at the beginning of the level, it is circled in red. Okay, so okay, here it's circled in red. So this is the target. So you have to focus on that. And then there is a number of flashes, and we record the data after each flashes, and we analyze the data, and then the machine decides what is the one to be destroyed. In this case, it was able to destroy the, also here, now this is the target. And now there are some distractors that have the same colors or different colors, but he has to concentrate on this one. And then the machine after 12, okay, in this case also, he was able to destroy the target at the first try. So in this case, now it is this one. So he has to focus on this one. Okay, so the flashes, there are 12 flashes in total. And then the machine makes the computation, half a second about, and then, okay, here the user was not successful. So he has lost life, and then he has a second possibility. So this is the one that he has to focus on. And then in this case, at the second, okay, now he arrived, and so on, until you finish the number of levels. So this is the way it works. So you see, it takes a number of seconds to make the decision, because we need enough data, okay? But it works actually pretty well. This user, for example, has about 95% of first trial successful success rate, which is actually very, very, very high. And the algorithm is actually very simple. As I showed you, we just compute covariance matrix, means, and then computed distance, and that's it. Okay? Okay, good. So I'm finished for this part. Just let me give you some resources. If you want to play with this data, we have published all this data. So there are over 1,400 sessions that are published. So you can find them in my webpage here. And also we have code in Julia. If you know this language, it's a kind of new language, very, very, very powerful for making maths, digital signal processing, Python, or in R, MATLAB, C++, even in Delphi. So we have code for all these languages. If you want, you can download it. So those are some of the collaborators that have been working on this project. And I think for the moment being, that's it. So thank you very much for your attention, and I guess see you later.
Thank you very much, Mario.
Yeah, I don't know if you want to answer questions now or later.
Well, I would say both. If people have questions now, it would be, I mean, if you have time, it would be good to answer now.
Karim has a question.
Karim has a question.
Hi, Karim.
Salut, ça va? Marco, nice to see you. Been a while.
Ça va, toi?
Oui, ça va, ça va.
Très bien.
Very nice presentation. I have one or two brief questions. So I'm super interested in the idea that to see whether we can try to apply this type of Riemannian classification on matrices that are not positive definite. What are the options in that case? Or, I mean, do you know of a mathematical solution to that? Or is it easy to turn such matrices that are not positive definite into a positive definite matrix without losing any, I mean, it might be, so, I mean, a sort of a any tricks that can be used so that we can use the method. So you see what I'm going, I'm heading for.
You gave yourself the answers, actually. Okay, there is this trick to make non-positive unit matrices to be positive definite, because any matrix multiplied by its transpose becomes positive definite. Actually, for example, my postdoc has been working on classification of movement. So in this case, it's a little bit more complicated because those are trajectories over time. So he has been doing this with the Kinect, Microsoft Kinect, okay? So you have some landmarks of some joints, and then you have to actually try to understand what are the movements, so the trajectories of those joints. And he has been coding the data using Hankel matrices, which are not positive definite. And then it takes the matrix times its transpose, it makes it positive definite, and then it applies exactly the same algorithm. It worked out very, very, very nice. So this is indeed one trick, okay? But there are also other manifolds that you can use for particular matrices. So there are manifolds for orthogonal matrices. There are manifolds for symmetric semi-positive definite matrices, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So if you have a manifold available, I mean, known, you can use it. If you don't, you can try to transform this matrix in a matrix that has a manifold that you can explore.
So that makes a lot of sense. Specifically, my question is also to specifically non-symmetric matrices.
Well, there is also manifold for invertible matrices, but not symmetric, but they must be invertible. So I had one PhD student actually did some very nice advances on that. He defined the metrics for this kind of manifold, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera.
So for an invertible but not symmetric, what would you use?
Well, then I can point to you this paper that has defined what they call the left and right matrix on those manifolds. But these manifolds are a little bit more complicated to use. For example, they don't have all the nice properties that I've been talking about. The geodesic, in some instances, is not even uniquely defined. So it's a little bit more complicated to work with those manifolds. But you can try. Otherwise, you can try to make this matrix symmetric with some symmetrization procedure. And if this matrix turns out to be positive definite, then you can use it.
Okay, so I might get back in touch with you about this. I don't want to take too much space here, but my question was to exactly if you're using, so for example, if you're using a spectral, the cross-spectral matrix, you can use, right? When you can have covariance of cross-spectral matrix.
If you're
using a directed measure of connectivity, then it's not symmetric anymore. So if you're using, for example, Granger, frequency domain Granger, or if you're using some
then
it's not actually symmetric anymore. And that's my specific question.
Yes, and actually I had these questions before by Hofe in Germany, and he had some idea of exploit some, now I don't remember, but he has some idea of exploiting some properties of those matrices to, because the exponential of those matrices, if I don't say something wrong, maybe orthogonal or something like that. So
Stefan Haufen?
Yeah, Stefan Haufen, yeah. Exactly, because I was visiting in Berlin, I was visiting Benjamin Blankers, and I saw him. He asked me exactly the same question, and he had some idea on transforming those matrices, because he's also working on Granger causality measures, but we couldn't figure it out at that time. I don't know if he has figured out in the meanwhile, but that would be actually very interesting.
Yeah, okay, thank you. Thank you a lot.
You're very welcome.
Nice talk.
Thank you. And it is Pierre that has some...
Yes, exactly, Pierre.
Okay,
should Pierre, I... Pierre, would you like to ask the question or... Yeah, I don't know.
I can answer directly. So what is the time duration the covariance matrices are typically computed on? I don't have a mic, no problem, Pierre. So what is the time duration the covariance matrices are typically computed on? Typically 1 second. But you can do as well with more, not much more, but more. a few seconds. You can do sometimes as well with half seconds or so. But of course, the less samples you have, the more the worse is the conditioning of the matrix. And that is something that you have to take care of. But what we do, we regularize those matrices by using some shrinkage procedure, for example, the very famous Led-Wattenwolf shrinkage. So you add basically some loads in the diagonals to make it better conditioned. And that actually works very fine. So you can actually do covariance estimation on smaller epochs, but also in our laboratory there is a guy that is actually working on some estimation of the distance in the case of very, 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 very small number of samples. But these are very theoretical things, but he has some results coming from the random matrix theory, for those that are familiar with those things. And using this theory of random matrices, he has some results on estimating the Fisher distance when you have very, very, the dimension of the matrix is much larger as compared to the number of samples, if this is what your problem is about. And the second question is, would it be possible to work on single trial data on either the manifold of the standard space? We do work on single trial data. Everything we do is on single trials. So I don't know if your question is more specific, please specify more. Thanks for your question.
I also have a small question, maybe very naive. So is it correct to say that, there's still Pierre.
Thanks to you, Pierre. Yeah, go ahead, Alberto.
So would it be correct to say that one of the key points is the use of the geometric mean rather than the arithmetic mean in these covariance matrices? Correct?
It is actually from a practical point of view.
And do you have like an intuition of why this works better? I mean.
Yes, because it's more resistant to outliers, and we have a lot of noise with the EG data. EG data is actually very noisy, and we have a lot of artifacts which are produced, but not by the brain, but other part of the body, like eye movement, muscle movement, etc. Or we have also instrumental artifacts, environmental artifacts. So all those artifacts, in many cases, have very strong power, which is actually stronger than the signal itself. So we need methods that are very robust with respect to outliers. And in this sense, the geometric mean distance are both robust. And then all those two invariances I've been talking about are also very important, because for example, if I put you an EG cap now, I train a classifier. Okay, and then I take out the cap and I put the cap again. Just because the electrons are not exactly in the same position, all the geometry of your problem is shift. Okay,
mm-hmm. Yeah.
So you need those form of invariances actually are very handy, because then it allows you to still work with your old classifier. Maybe it's not optimal, but it's still much better than, for example, a classifier that you have been computing using spatial filters, which are very specific for that kind of positions and on the other.
Yeah, I see. Thank you very much.
So there is another question by Andreas. Is all the geometry lost?
Yeah,
a new rotation?
Your last comment, is it all the geometry lost, or is it just because you have an uncertainty of a rotation? Because this goes against what you said at the beginning, which is very true, that if you work in the sensor space, it's the same as working in the source space. Therefore, you have a representation that is almost identical, at least as far as these bits are concerned. So my guess is that the only thing that is happening, you introduce a small rotation, and of course that destroys everything in an all-Riemannian manifold. But if you can find this rotation, you're back into your original transformation. Or am I wrong?
No, indeed. What we used to do before was to estimate those rotation which are spatial filters indeed. But now we don't do that anymore because we find that working with the original data using this metric is even more effective than try to estimate those rotation.
Great, thanks.
So I was also curious, you showed that video which the guy had to shoot the alien.
Mm-hmm.
Was it like the first, so because you said that these new methods are training less.
Yes.
So there's no need for, but of course at the beginning there's some sort of adaptation, right, to the subject. So was that?
No. It adapts all the time.
All the time.
But at the beginning, it's suboptimal because at the beginning, there is no data to adapt. So it uses the database. But then in 30, 40 seconds, it becomes nearly optimal.
Okay. So the part of the video was the beginning, like the, or was it?
No. Yeah. When it starts playing is the beginning. So in his case, it works straight away.
Mm-hmm.
But also, I mean, the adaptation is very simple because you just move those center of mass toward the data that you observe. So you adapt the center of mass to the user, basically.
Yeah.
And you move along geodesic with some steps, which are decreasing over time, and that's it.
Okay.
That's
very simple adaptation. Simple and effective.
It works. It works unless if the subject at the beginning start mixing a lot of artifacts, then the adaptation will actually go worse. But it happens, but we have seen it rarely. And then you should try to prevent this to happen, but trying to recognize if the incoming data is good or not.
Mm-hmm.
It would be possible, but this is not something that is very interesting to us, but it could be done. So you don't adapt if the data is bad. Basically, you could do that.
Yeah. Okay. And another question. So basically, when they have to kill an alien in one place or in the other one, so is that a different pattern you're looking for?
What happens is that all the aliens flashes two times, exactly two times, okay? And when it is the target flash, so we need to know the moment in time where is the flash. And then we look at 1 second after that, and there is an evoked response in the brain, which is different if the alien is the target or is not the target.
Okay.
So the classification becomes a two-class classification, target versus non-target. And doing in finding out those potentials that are related to the target, which are the attentional potentials Karim was talking about, then we can determine what is the most likely target, and then we destroy that one.
Okay.
So it's a matter of it's not mind reading. It's a matter of interpreting the response of the brain to the flashes, to the visual flashes.
Okay, I see.
So it's okay, thank you. We are very far, no way to read the mind. A trick, actually. We are just using tricks. It's illusionism. Like taking the hat and the gun, yes. But it works. For those simple things, it works, but of course.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
Shall we go on with the second part?
Sure. Yes, so I should, here we go. Yeah. Can you see the screen?
Yes.
All right. So in this part, I would like to talk about more recent things that we have been doing. So we have been working on Riemannian geometry for EEG in the last 10 years. What I've been showing you is what I've been doing in the first years. And now what I'm going to show you what we have been doing in the last years. So we have been actually attacking the problem of transfer learning, which is the problem of how to get rid of the calibration in a more principled way as compared to what we were doing before. So the idea to go beyond the test training paradigm. So test training means that now, when you do when you participate to a BCI experiment, there is a test phase in which you have to train. There is a training phase in which you have to train basically the classifier, in which you do not use actually the BCI. And then once the classifier has been trained, then you start using the BCI. So this is the traditional way of operation, but we want to get completely rid of that. And we want to do that in a more principled way as compared to what we were doing before. So the way this would work is that there is an initial state of the machine, which is completely unsupervised, that we don't know anything about the new user, okay? Is a new user coming? We don't know anything, so we need to initialize somehow the machine. And then data comes in, and then we want to do in a semi-supervised way, we want to adapt, basically, the classifier to the incoming data, okay? So this is the way actually we want this thing to operate. And what I'm going to talk today is four things. One is what we can do to do some unsupervised transfer learning. Okay, unsupervised means that we do not know at all the label of the data, okay? So we do not know if the data we are observing is from one class or the other. Then what we call semi-supervised transfer learning is something different. In this case, we know the labels, but we know only a few of them, okay? And then I'm going to show a very interesting advance, which is heterogeneous domain adaptation, how we can transfer learning from one domain to another when those domains are heterogeneous, in the sense that when the number and even what electrodes we are using are not the same. The reason why we need to do that is that every laboratory uses a different set of electrodes, okay? So sometimes 8 or 16 or 32 or 64 or 128, and they are not always the same. So now, to the best of my knowledge, it's a very difficult problem how to use some pre-existing data, for example, from some experiment done by Karim in Montreal using 128 electrodes. How can I use this for my setting where I have 128 electrodes, but they are not in the same position, for example, or I have 256 electrodes? Of course, in general, I'm not able to use this data, but we have worked out a way to use this data nonetheless. So what we called heterogeneous domain adaptation. And then I'm going to talk about something that we call metadatabases, which means using this heterogeneous domain adaptation, how we can take all the data that is available, all of them, and construct a huge metadatabase, a database of databases, one single database that has all the data in, even if they are heterogeneous, okay? So why we want to do that is because, but of course, the more data we have, the better we can learn and the better we can transfer learning. And also because there is a trend in the community of using deep learning algorithms, and deep learning algorithms actually needs to use a lot of data to learn. So they are effective when they have a lot of data to learn, and the EG community, we don't have a lot of data because taking data is time consuming, is expensive, and it's not as simple as taking a picture. Okay, so making an EEG experiment takes hours, and it's not as simple as making a picture. So we don't have millions of EEG sessions. We have maybe thousands of EEG sessions if you are lucky. So how we can increase the number of data? Well, we can increase the data if we are able to put together data coming from different labs with different settings, with different amplifier, et cetera, and try to merge all these in a single, what we call a meta database.
So this is what we are going to talk now. Okay, so we have seen the basic concepts, which are the geodesic, the distance, the mean, in the Riemannian manifold of positive definite matrices. So we have defined them, we have seen the properties, so that's fine. And we have seen how we can apply Riemannian minimum distance to mean classifiers, in which is a very simple classifier working on the manifold. Okay, so I'm not going to go back to this. And before I can start talking, let me just introduce a family of methods to visualize high dimensional data in small dimensions. So the dimension of a positive, the dimension of the manifold of positive definite matrix is equal to n times n minus 1 divided by 2, so meaning the number of diagonal element and the number of off diagonal element in one side only. So this is the dimension of the manifold. So if you have, for example, 16 electrons, it's very high. So how we can visualize this data in lower dimension, like Q, for example, like here, then we use those methods called spectral embedding, for example. And the idea of spectral embedding is to use Laplacian matrices. Okay, so like this is the Laplacian matrices where we define, so let me see if I can get rid of this thing. We define a kernel to, and then we define a distance matrix. Okay, so from this distance matrix, from any pair of observations, then we have a Laplacian, which is kind of normalization of this matrix. And then the eigenvector of this matrix give us coordinates to visualize this data in lower dimension, in the sense that a few of those eigenvectors typically hold enough information to see how this data behave in lower dimension. Okay, so for example, here you have the data, which is visualized taking the first and the second eigenvector of the Laplacian. And then you can see that there is some separation in this target and non-target. So this is real data from P300 experiment. As I told you, Alberto, before, we have some target data, which is the covariance matrix after the target alien is flashed, and non-target, which is the covariance matrix after a non-target alien is flashed. So there are many more, because there are many more non-targets as compared to target. And there is some separation between the two, and which can be visualized in two dimensions using those kind of methods called spectral embedding. But there are many methods that can do that. We are going to use that a lot. For example, let me give you an overview of the transfer learning problem. Just take a look at this data, which is from a BCI competition data. So this is a motor imagery BCI. So it's a brain computer interface in which we imagine to move the hands. And when we imagine to move, we are able to say, I mean, to guess if you are, for example, imagining to moving the right hand or the left hand, we can tell, so that you can make a binary choice. So this data comes from 9 subjects that performed 2 different sessions with 22 electrodes. And in this case were 4 classes. So these guys were actually imaging not only to move the hands, but also the tongue and the feet. But what is interesting is that every subject is in a different part of this space. So there is a separation, which actually tells us there is a shift in the data from one subject to the other. So a classifier that is computed on one subject will not work very well on another subject. And also that from one session to the other, the separation can be very, 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 very high. So for example, 2 blocks of different of the same colors, those are the violet, for example, those are 2 sessions of the same subject, and you see there is a shift. So if you have a decision functions like a line like this, it would work for this session, but it will not work for the other session. So that's why we need to do a calibration now every time, even for a subject that we already know. But the simple fact that we do another session in another day makes the classifier not useful anymore. Okay, so there is a big shift of the data from one session to the other, and even more from one subject to the other.
So we could do what we call naive transfer learning, which is how the Brain Invaders works. And that is, we could take database from previous users, compute covariance matrices, because we know the label, target and non-target, if for a P300 or whatever they are, compute some the geometric mean, and then use those geometric mean at the beginning to initialize the machine, okay? So this is what we call naive transfer learning, okay? And let me show you in practice what it gives you in terms of accuracy of your classifiers. So here you have an experiment that we've been doing in our GIPSA laboratory for P300, so Brain Invaders. We took 7 subjects doing 8 sessions each, okay? So we could see what happened when we apply some cross-subject and cross-session transfer learning, not learning. So in the first column gives you the accuracy measured by the mean area under the curve, which is one way to measure accuracy. For 3 classifiers, so we took the MDM, which is the Riemannian classifier in red, and then we took one, what we call hard machine learning approach. So this algorithm is stepwise linear discriminant analysis, was very fashionable at that time, but it's really hard machine learning. The more data you give, the better. And then we took a spatial filter called X-Down, okay? So very different algorithms. And then we see what happened. So in the classical test training fashion, I mean, using the data from the same session, then we have those results, which are in the first column. And we see that the MDM is actually as good as X-Down and better than the stepwise linear discriminant analysis. And then we did some naive cross-subject transfer learning, meaning that we are using the data from all the other subjects to classify the remaining subject. And then, of course, you see now a drop in the performance. The mean IUC drops from about 89 to about 84, okay? So there's a drop in the performance, but still, the MDM is better than the others and this is significantly better than the others. So it's more robust to those shifts, as we said before. And then we did some cross-session transfer learning, meaning that we are using the data from all the other sessions, not the existing, the actual one, to train the classifier, and we test on the data of that session. And here we see something interesting, that is the MDM is very efficient even when only one session is used for that subject. But, and then it gets better and better when more sessions are available. Whereas we see that the spatial filter, it's very efficient at the beginning, but then it becomes less efficient. And that is why, and why this is the case, is because the spatial filter is very sensitive to where the electrodes are placed. So it becomes suboptimal when these electrodes have been moving from one session to the other. And then we see that the stepwise linear discriminant analysis, on the other hand, is not efficient at all when only one session is used. But then when more data is provided, more session, then it becomes better and better and better, okay? So those two kinds of families of algorithms is very different behavior. And the Riemannian MDM looks like it takes the best part of all of them, in the sense that it's very efficient with little data, and the more data we have, it gets better and better and better, okay? So this is about naive transfer learning. So now let's see what we can do in a supervised, unsupervised manner. So here is the idea, is to exploit the parallel transport I was talking about, okay? And the idea is to take data. Okay, now I'm going to use colors to code, and we are going to have target data and source data, okay? So we want to apply the source, the learning that we have on the source data to the target data. So we want to learn, we want to transfer learning from the source to the target. So what we are going to do is we are going to transfer by parallel transport all data from the source to the identity, okay? And all the data from the target to the identity, so that both of them now are centered in the same place. And now we can use the data from the source to classify the target, okay? So this is done very simply by whitening, as I explained before, where G is the center of mass of the source and of the target. So once we have computed the center of mass, we can parallel transport this data to the identity very simply. And then all the data is centered to the identity. And then we do the classification that we have learned on the source on the target data, okay? And this is completely unsupervised because we don't need to know the labels of the source data or of the target data at all, okay? Because this center of mass is the global center of mass of all the data that we have. So this is very simple and still is very effective. So this is a demonstration how effective it is using another visualization technique, which is called TSME, but doesn't matter. So here we have data from BCI competition 4, the same data as before, 9 subjects, 2 sessions, 4 classes. And here we have data from left hand imagery, which is the first column, right hand, second column, feet movement, third column, and tongue movement, fourth column. And the first line is the original data, and the top line, and the bottom line is the data transformed by recentering. And as you can see, from one session to the other, which are coded by color, so red is one session one and blue is session two, as you can see, there is a separation in the original data, which is partially compensated in the transformed data. So this recentering, which is completely unsupervised, is kind of effective. And this is another example where you have subject one and you have the original data. So here now you have the data for all the 4 classes coded by color, and the 2 sessions are coded by different symbol, okay? So you have the disk is session one and the asterisk is session two. So you see in the original data, there is a clear separation from one session to the another. And when you do recentering, then the data is much more mixed together and there is much less separation between the 2 sessions, okay? So you are actually just recentering the data to the identity, which is a whitening, nothing more than that. You are actually operating transfer learning from session to session in an effective way. So we have also, of course, done statistics on that. Okay, I'm not going into the details, but just to show you that when compared to the naive approach, the recentering approach is significantly better, of course, especially for what we call the good subjects. So meaning for subjects that have a high accuracy, for those subjects, the recentering is actually very effective. So you improve by 5 the accuracy score. Whereas for the bad subject, those that have low accuracy, it doesn't work much, very much. And so this is in cross session, but when we do cross subject transfer learning, it's even better because in this case, we go from 38.8 to 63.8, which is a 25-point increase. So that's kind of huge. So it works both in cross session and in cross subject. So that was motor imagery, BCI, but we also have done that for P300 BCI, like the Brain Invaders. So this is actually Brain Invaders data. And here we have a different score of accuracy, which is called the precision, true positive divided by true positive plus false positives. We use this score because the class are unbalanced in this case, but in any case, it doesn't matter. And here we see that again, for the good subject, we have a very nice cross-subject transfer learning. On the right, you see that the recentering, as compared to the naive approach, gives you a 46% increase of accuracy in terms of precision, which is again very, 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 very high. So this actually works very fine. It's very simple. It's very easy. And it's completely unsupervised. So this is actually a very handy procedure. Okay, so now let's see what we can do in a semi-supervised setting In a semi-supervised setting, we have access to a few label of data at the beginning of the experiment. Suppose that you initialize the data somehow, you do some unsupervised learning, and then you start having some data from that subject that is operating in the BCI. And suppose that you have access to a few labels of this data. Now, how can I use this few label to do an even better transfer learning? Okay, so this is like the second stage of the operation. We start with some unsupervised transfer learning, and then we have some data. Can we use that now in a semi-supervised way, meaning only a few labels, to improve even further? So in that case, the idea is this. If we have some original data, okay, of course we can recenter the data, but maybe we can do some other operations in order to align this data better. And particularly we can do some stretching of the data in such a way to equalize the dispersion of the data of one subject or the other, if it is cross subject transfer learning, or from one session to the other, because we want the dispersion of the data to be the same. And then we can try to find the optimal rotation in such a way to align this data. So you see, when we do recentering here, the data is not very well aligned, but if we could find an optimal rotation, then we could actually align the classes. And of course, in order to do that, we need to do that in a supervised way. So this thing can be done, and it actually corresponds, it is actually a Riemannian version of the famous Procrustes analysis in a Euclidean setting. So what I'm going to talk about here is a Procrustes analysis in a Riemannian setting. So the original data is first recentered by some whitening. Then it is stretched, and actually in a Riemannian setting, the stretching operation, since the data has been recentered, is amounts to exponentiating those data by some scalars, because actually this makes, I'm going to show you what this does. And then we want to find a rotation for this data in such a way to align the data and in particular to align the classes, okay? So now we have three operations instead of only one, not only recentering and not only stretching, both of them are unsupervised, but we also have a rotation, and this is a supervised steps, okay? So we have three steps, we have two more as compared to recentering. So stretching is very simple. You just exponentiate, as I told you, the data, for example, of the target subject, so the one on which you want to operate the learning. And this, if P is larger than one, will make the dispersion bigger. If P is smaller than one, we'll make the dispersion smaller. And then you find this P in such a way to equalize the dispersion for the target and the subject and the source subject. This is the equation that you have on the bottom. Okay, so this is nothing more than the dispersion. So the sum of all the distances from the identity for the target subject and the source subject. So you find the P that equalize these two dispersions. And that's a very simple task. Once you have done it, you can transform one of the two in such a way to equalize the dispersion. And then we get to the rotation, okay? So as I told you before, when we recenter, not necessarily you are aligning the classes properly. So you want to align as it is shown in the figure, okay? And this is done by rotation. And in order to find this rotation, we apply an optimization process. So we solve this problem, which is minimization problem, finding the orthogonal matrix U in such a way that for the distance between the geometric mean or center of mass of the different classes is minimized, okay? So as shown in the figure, we minimize the distance between geometric mean coming from the same class. And in this case, we hope to align the data in such a way that the classifier, in the simple case, would be just in hyperplane here, would be much, much more efficient when the data has been rotated, as opposed when the data is not, in contrast to when the data is not rotated. So this is the third step, rotation. So in a nutshell, what we want to do is this. We take the target data and then we apply this operation. Okay, so if you see in the order, you are doing a whitening, an exponentiation, stretching, and a rotation. So everything is written in this equation. So RPA amounts to do this transformation on the target data in such a way to align it as much as possible to the source data. Okay, so this is how it works on some real data from another database called CHO 2017, Motor Imagery for the subject. So this is just one of them, 23 electrodes. So the original data points after recentering, after stretching, and after rotation. So you can see that after each step, the separation between the classes becomes better and better and better. And we have been validating this approach using a lot of databases from both Motor Imagery, another BCI paradigm called SSVEP, and P300 data. Okay, so I'm not going to details, but we have found it pretty effective for all of them. And one way to show what we got is to use those plots. So in those plots, now you have on the for each plot, you have the lines are the source subject and the columns are the target subject. So we take every source subject and we apply transfer learning for every target subject. Of course, we do not consider the case when the source subject is the same of the target subject, because it's the same subject, so there is no transfer learning in this case, but in all the other, there is. And now we are color coding the accuracy that we are obtaining in IUC terms, so area under the curve, in such a way that dark means good accuracy, high accuracy, and white means low accuracy. And what we are doing, we are applying a method called seriation in order to make some patterns appear. Otherwise, it's completely unreadable. And seriation, it just means that we are going to sort the columns and the lines by their marginals. Okay, so we sort the columns and the lines, and so some patterns then appears. And then you see that as compared to the original data, which is the first line of four plots, okay, every column is a number of training points that we are using. Because remember, we need some label trials to do this rotation. How many trials we are going to use? One, which is actually not much, nothing at all. 5, 10, and 25. Okay, the more we use, the better the results, of course. And then in the second line, you see the effect of recentering. And in the third line, you see the effect of a Riemannian Proclusis analysis, which is recentering, stretching, and rotation. Okay. And so what you can see here is that RPA works better than recentering, especially when more trials are available. And also you see that when the target is good subject, then doesn't matter what is the source that you take, in general, you are able to achieve very high transfer learning, okay? So for example, take as an example here, the last plot, in the lower right corner, then you see that here for subjects that are target subjects that are good. So the first one is the one that has overall highest accuracy, the first line. Then you see that the line is black everywhere. Doesn't matter what is the source subject, it works for him. Whereas for bad subject, which are on the right columns, so they have white everywhere. It doesn't matter what source you use, then the results is going to be bad in any case, okay? But as compared to the original data, then you got much better results. And that is the point that we needed to make, okay? So this method is also kind of effective. So this is another database, doesn't matter. But the question is, okay, so... One important question is this. Okay, so I'm saying that we need to use a few labels. We need to know a few labels from the current session in order to make this rotation. So why you don't use those labels just to make a calibration? Okay, so here we are comparing what if we just make a calibration with those labels, or if you use those labels in RPA to do transfer learning, and we see So if the dots are in the gray area, calibration is better than RPA. And if the dots are in the white area, then RPA is better than calibration. And actually we found that statistically RPA is better than calibration. So it is actually better to use RPA to do transfer learning instead of using this data to do a mini calibration when the data is available. Okay, so transfer learning is more effective than just do a calibration with data available points. Okay, so that was semi-supervised transfer learning. And then I told you, okay, and now how can we do transfer learning when the data is heterogeneous, in the sense that in our case, that means that the number and or the position of electrodes is not the same. So how can I use another database, maybe of another laboratory, to do transfer learning on a subject that comes in my laboratory to do the BCI? Okay, so this is a question that has never been answered before in our field, to the best of my knowledge. So we proposed a method to do that, and we gave to this method the name dimensionality transcending. And the reason why we gave this name is going to be evident pretty soon. So let's make a practical example. So here is a database which has 14 electrodes which are in those positions on the scalp. And here there is another existing real database that has 13 electrodes with those positions on the scalps. So nothing of what we have said before apply. We can do nothing, not even recentering, not, of course, not stretching. And of course, we cannot do rotation because those positive definite matrices, those covariance matrices, are completely different in size. So they are even different manifolds. And of course, the structure is completely different. So how can we find the common space between those two? So this is the question. I don't know if you can think at a solution to this question right now. How can you define a common space? Actually, there is a very simple way, and that is to consider the union superspace, which is the union of those electrodes and those electrodes, okay? So the union of those two positions is what you see here on the right, and it is a union comprised of 18 electrodes. Some of them comes from this, some of them comes from the other, and some of them comes from both of them, okay? But now we have defined a common space. And now we have to define a general form of a transcending operator, okay? And this general form, it is like this. So basically now we want to take the data from this database from 13 electrodes and put it in the space of 18 electrodes, okay? So the data from this database is this matrix C. So we need to complete this matrix by a matrix V here, a matrix V transpose because the matrix is symmetric, and the matrix A here, okay? Once we have done that, then we need to apply a permutations of the rows and or the columns in such a way that the position of those electrodes will be the same for all of them. For example, I mean, the position of those of the common electrodes here must be the same for those two databases. Okay, that's clear. So we need to apply a permutation in such a way to match the position of the common electrodes between all the databases. And that's not a problem at all. The problem here is how you define V and A. And now how you define this V and A? So this is the question. And the solution that we have found is actually deceivingly simple. But before I give you the solution, let me tell you how we found this solution. We wanted a transcending operator T. So remember, the transcending operator T is this one, okay? Permutation V and A. So we want a transcending operator in such a way that it does not change the distance between any two points of the original space, okay? So we want to preserve the distance of the point in the original space, and we want this transcending operator to preserve those distances, okay? So there are maybe many operators that can do that, but there is one that is particularly interesting and very simple, which is to put zero here and the identity matrix here. So this is very simple, but it does satisfy this property, okay? So this is the solution of the transcending operator, a permutation matrix, which is very simple to find. And then we trail the matrix with zero in the off diagonal here. I mean, in the off diagonal block here, and the identity matrix in the diagonal block here, and that's it. Once we have done that, we can basically bring all the databases to a common superspace, which is the union superspace. We can do that. And now, once they are in the common superspace, they are comparable, and we can apply the same machinery of Riemannian geometry that we have been applying so far. Okay? And actually, it turns out that such way to operate is called, it actually follows what we call the maximum entropy data imputation principle, which in a Bayesian kind of frame of mind means that we are assuming no knowledge whatsoever on how, I mean, we have the least possible knowledge on how this transcending operator should be defined. And this is the solution that that turns out to be the one that satisfies this property. So I'm not going into the detail, but of course we have tested this on many situations. So here, for example, we have two databases, and we are actually comparing the calibration with the data, the dimensionality transcending plus Riemannian precursors analysis, because once we have done the dimensionality transcending, now we can use the Riemannian precursors analysis to learn from one database and apply this learning to the other database. And once we do that, when we use, for example, this BNCI database as a target and this zoo database as a source, okay? And using N is the number of target trials that are assumed to be known, because RPA is, as I told you, semi-supervised procedure. Then when we do that, we find out that calibration, which is in parentheses, the accuracy that we obtain just by using the typical calibration is less than the accuracy that we obtain using this dimensionality transcending. And this is significant when the asterisk is there. In the other plot, we have done the same things, but the other way around, using the one, the other, using the source as a target and the target as a source here. And then we obtain those results here. So although the improvement is not dramatical in this case, we have still obtained one interesting results that that can lead us to the next part of the talk. But before doing that, just let me tell you that if you want to do that dimensionality transcending plus Riemannian precursors analysis, all is done by doing those operations in this order. So remember, before we were doing a recentering, and then there is this stretching with the P, okay? And then you need to transcend this in a higher dimension, which is the union superspace. And then you need a permutation matrix to match the common electrodes. And finally, you do a rotation. So basically, you can put all those things we have been describing so far, everything we've been talking so far, in this equation. So this is the transformation that you need to apply to the data in such a way to do dimensionality transcending plus Riemannian precursors analysis. So it's a simple non-linear, because this P is actually non-linear, but it's non-linear, but it's a simple transformation. All right, so what we can use this for, but the idea is to use this to merge databases, meaning to take many databases and to create one big, huge database where we can actually start to do some serious learning, for example, by deep learning or other methods. But the interesting, the seducing idea of this is that in theory, we could use all the databases existing in the world to create one single huge database. Okay? And the way to do this is just to do dimensionality transcending and then to do some alignment on this data. So we have started doing this here. For example, we have how the data of different databases looks like in three dimension by spectral embedding. In this case, it's the TSNE method. Of course, every database is a completely different space. And then once we have done the dimensionality transcending, we can start manipulate those data. And then you see what happened after recentering. And then you see what happened after stretching. And then you see what happened after rotation. And it's very interesting that after rotation, the different classes, which are coded by different symbols, the triangles are class 2, the disks are class 1. And then you see that all the triangles are here and all the disks are here. So actually you can get a separation of classes, even if you have been considering in this case 2, 4, 6 different databases, you see? So if you keep doing this exercise with more and more and more and more and more databases, can you now try to build such huge meta databases? And this is the last thing I wanted to talk to you. So again, this is the data that you can, the data that we have been collecting that you can download and use anytime. And if you need code, just go to my webpage or my GitHub, and then you will find code. I now code in Julia, but my collaborators code in Python, R, MATLAB, blah, blah, etc. So we have code in different languages that you can use straight away. And thank you very much for your attention. And I am done.
Thank you very much, Marco. Thanks a lot, really. Very, very, very interesting. And full of interesting details. I think that's exactly what we were hoping for. Let's see if there are questions from the audience. Not so far. So I have a question which is not really technical, but because you say that you say we're not reading the mind, this is just tricks. I mean, they are tricks that require a lot of effort anyway and require a lot of work, as you just showed us, particularly for making it like more usable, like in this case, which you want to transfer. My question is, what do you think would be the next step in these tricks? And what is currently like the most difficult task that can be accomplished with these tricks?
I think that we have pretty much reached the optimum of what can be done with the EEG to operate BCI. I mean, we can improve a little bit this part of the signal processing chain. We can improve robustness, of course. We can improve transfer learning. We can improve usability. We can improve ergonomy, like using an EEG handset that is actually very simple to put, that everybody can put at home, for example. But we can improve those kind of things. But when it comes to accuracy, there has been research for over 30 years now. And we have pretty much over the top. I mean, we cannot do much better than that. For example, if you want to make a Space Invaders that goes faster, instead of taking 6 seconds to take a decision, you want that to take 3 seconds, okay, that's feasible. But if you want that to be done in 500 milliseconds, it's absolutely impossible. There is no way with EEG that we can do that, because 500 milliseconds is not the duration of even one trial, okay?
Yeah.
So that would be, let's say 500 milliseconds would be the strictly minimum to be able to give to make a classification, okay? But that would be not very efficient. And of course, much more efficient would be to take your mouse and click on the alien, you see? So there is no way that the BCI can actually get to the point of replacing yes. traditional interface. There is no way that actually can get to the point where you can read into the brain or do much more complex task. It is just impossible, because there are billions and billions and billions of neurons in the brain, and we are using 16, 20, 100 electrodes. So you can understand, of course, it's just, and the electrodes are pretty far from the brain, and then there are a lot of noise interference. So there is no way we can do any better with this modality. It is in principle possible to do much better if you start implanting electrodes inside the brain. And this is what some part of the industry is now looking at. Elon Musk with Neuralink is working on those ideas. Other people are working on those ideas. And there are some transhumanism trends to implant more and more things into the brain. But I am personally completely against those kind of approach. And from philosophical and ethical, even political, if you want, point of view, I'm completely opposed. I refuse to work on those things. I refuse even to review papers working with these methods. And I don't want to have anything to do with those things. And I don't see the interest of doing those things either. So, to answer your questions, if you want to do more, then you have to go into the brain, but that would be very, very, very dangerous. And that would open the way to all kinds of manipulation and all kinds of possible reading of kind of possible privacy violation and all kind of possible of denaturation. Yeah, of
dystopian.
Dystopian distortion of the human being. Mm. So I'm not... I don't see this as a desirable future. Let's put it that way.
Okay, thanks. There are a couple of more questions in the chat. So, Roberto.
Yeah, maybe it's related. Hello, thank you for the talk.
Yeah, welcome, it was Roberto.
Really, really inspiring. I was wondering if maybe it's a silly question, as I said in the chat, but do you think that you could align also different modalities of imaging, like, you know, MEG data and EEG data in some sense in this with this kind of approaches, or even other modalities? Yeah
that's that would be great, but what we have been talking about assumes that the modality is the same, for the simple reason that once you have, let's say, a covariance matrix, this covariance matrix is a structure. And this structure reflects, in our case, the spatial information in the brain. So, of course, if you take at the same time, for example, some EMG, the spatial information would be completely different, and this would not work. So what you're talking about is another line of research, which is how to merge together data that comes from different modalities. And that is... something that I personally have not worked in. One of my colleagues, Christian Schutten, has worked on those problems, but not myself. And what I've been talking about cannot be used for those things, because the structure will be completely different. So even if you do all this operation, the point will be completely different, because the coordinates of those points in space are completely different, and there is no way to align them, because they are just different structures. So I mean, it's not something that you can solve by means of rotation, stretching, or stuff like that. It's just completely different structure. So I guess what you need to do is to extract some features out of those things, and then maybe you can merge those. But working in the covariance space of heterogeneous data in the sense of different modalities? No, I don't see how this could work.
Okay, thank you so much.
We also have a question by Andreas.
Just the first operation that you do, you transfer to the identity matrix, but that's just you take the average of all the cases that you have. Why don't you apply selection there? Or even selecting the subjects which are more similar to the two that you're going to do?
Transfer. Yeah, absolutely. Actually, what you're saying turns out to be the good way to do. Mm-hmm. You don't always gain doing transfer learning. Yeah. You can even lose something. So yes, and actually this is something that should be, I mean, is a line of research that has not been explored fully. So what kind of data you should use for doing transfer learning? So some selection would be actually beneficial to the overall results for sure. We have seen that. We have seen that many, 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 many times. Actually, for each subject, there are some subjects that are good for doing transfer learning. There are others that are not good, and they are not always the same. So now the problem is, how should you a priori select those subjects? This actually is one direction I wanted to take, but so far I didn't have an opportunity yet.
Thank you.
There is also a question from Victoria.
Exactly. Yeah, Victoria. Please.
Very inspiring talk. So I was wondering if this transcending operator, how would it behave when you would try to merge data sets with no common sensor? And
In that case, it would actually not work. Actually, what this transcending operator allows you to do is to exploit this common operation, this common space, and then to assume that when it is not common, basically, it's just like you are filling the non-common electrodes with white noise, which means you are assuming nothing, no information whatsoever. And that works if there is some common signal, but if there is any, then you're just comparing noise with noise, so they would be completely random.
Okay. So can I imagine this? There must be kind of some angle to combine.
Yeah, something in common there should be. Otherwise, that would not work. But you can define a transcending operator differently. If you define a transcending operator differently, instead of filling this matrix with zero and identity matrix, you can try to use other things, and then you can get the better results. So that we did not try, but it is in principle, you have in principle way to inform the operator with some data that you have, because you have some data, it's just not in the common space, but you have it. If you can, you may find some way to use this data to define another transcending operator, which is informed, and then it would work, but we didn't do that.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you very much. I see no further questions. So I think it's time to thank you again a lot, Marco, for the
thank you very much.
Your very long presentation, very beautiful presentation. Thank you for being here with us.
Yeah.
And
thank you.
Thanks. So for today, we finish here. With the workshop, and we start again tomorrow at 9:30, I think. So tomorrow the order is reversed. Like, we have the long presentations in the morning and like the shorter presentations in the afternoon. And so thanks to everyone for being here, and see you tomorrow morning.
Thanks.
Bye bye. Bye.